Today's tinkering is accompanied by Get Up Off of That Thang, a soulful brown ale by Devil May Care Brewing in Winnipeg. I've had this one a couple of times, and I do really like it, even though it's not as heavy and dark as a stout or a porter. It is a really good beer. So today, I'm going to be tinkering with these ADS1115 modules that I got in the last mailbag. These, for those of you who were there at the time or have seen that video, these are a four-port, four-input analog-to-digital converter. On the module, we have power and ground, as you'd expect, SCL and SDA, so it speaks I2C. It has an address input, an alert input, which is optional, and then the four analog inputs. This seems to be a really useful little board, so I think today would be an excellent time to spend a little bit of time playing with it and just seeing some of the use I can put it to. But in order to make use of it, I'm going to have to solder it up, and I'm going to need a microcontroller to work with it. So I'll have to, I think I'm going to choose a microcontroller that doesn't have very many analog inputs, which would be any of the ESP8266 or ESP family of microcontrollers. But for this, I think I will use a D1 Mini. Oh, there's one that's already got pins on it. So a little bit less soldering that I'll have to do. Cool. So I'll just quickly solder this guy up so that I can use it, and we'll come back in a minute. Alrighty then, here we have it on a breadboard. I've wired the I2C, SCL, and SDA up through a level shifter, just a standard little level shifter board. They're cheap and plentiful. That way I can run this guy off 5 volts rather than the 3.3 volts that the D1 speaks. So I can get a little bit wider use out of this thing, measure a little bit wider set of voltages. So I guess the first thing to do would probably be to find out what the I2C address of this thing is. And to do that, we will use just the standard I2C detect sketch. What it does is just quickly scan through all the possible I2C addresses that exist and reports back on what responds on the bus. In this case, that address is 48. Not 48 because this is hexadecimal, so it's 48. But if you remember, there was an address pin on that module. So I think we should at least have access to a few other addresses. So let's just take that address pin low and see what happens. No change, so low must be its default state. Okay. In that case, let's take it to 5 volts and see what happens. Ah, 49. Okay, so we've got a couple addresses to play with. That means we can have even more analog inputs on our microcontroller. Excellent. However, looking at the data sheet, it tells me that there is actually 4 possible addresses. So if I take that address pin to SDA or SCL, I should get a couple more addresses. Okay. So let's try that. Where is SDA? Is there? Oh, we get 4A. Okay. How about if we try SCL? Come on, get in there. 4B. Okay, so there is our 4 possible addresses. So if we can address 4 of these things, and there's 4 analog inputs each, we've got 16 analog inputs we can play with. Since I've got the data sheet up, how about I actually look at it a little bit here? Just so we know what we're dealing with, rather than diving in all half-cocked, which is, you know, my normal mode. So the supply voltage can be anywhere from 2 volts to 5.5 volts. It can have either 4 analog inputs or 2 differential inputs, so measuring the difference between 2 voltages. Simplify block diagrams. So there looks like there's a whole family of these similar ones, but this particular one, the 1115, has 16-bit resolution, and it has the most input pins at that high resolution. Okay, there's the recommended operating voltages. Again, the supply between 2 and 5.5 volts, full-scale
input up to 6.14 volts. Oh, okay, so it can actually measure voltages higher than VCC, which I assume means that it's voltage dividing stuff down inside it. That just makes sense. Operating temperature from ridiculous to ridiculous. High impedance inputs. Yeah, okay. Data rates up to 860 samples per second. I don't know, what else do we really need to know here? So it looks like it takes the four inputs one at a time and switches them through the PGA, which in this case has nothing to do with pro golfers, and it is not, as I initially thought, a programmable gate array. It is a programmable gain array. Then it just goes into the 16-bit analog to digital converter and then out over the I2C interface. I think that's about all we need to know for what we're doing here right now. This is all fancy timing stuff. If I was writing a library, this might be useful, but I'm not writing a library. I am using existing libraries. And it appears that there are several libraries to choose from. You may notice I've got a couple of them already installed that I'm playing with. So let's start with the... Actually, there's one more that doesn't show up on this page, which is the Adafruit one. So let's start there because that's a convenient place that a lot of people are going to start. There's a few things in the examples that come with the Adafruit library that you can configure. You can choose if you want to use the 16-bit version or the 12-bit version. Obviously, I'm using the 16-bit version. And what else? You can set the gain. I'm just going to leave it a default for now. Other than that, it just goes through, does reads, and computes the voltages, and then displays them like that. So I don't have any voltages connected right now for it to measure, so let's go and do that. So let's just put one of them, how about a zero, over to, how about the 5-volt input for now. I'll plug these batteries in as well. Why is that battery got two magnets on it? I love these little spherical magnets, by the way. They are just so handy for doing that with. Let's put that lithium ion onto A1. Let's connect up this AA battery to something. How about the third input? Sure. And let's just put an arbitrary voltage onto the fourth input that we can change with this thing here. Connect to ground. What's it set for right now? It's set for 4 volts. Okay, now let's go and see what's happening. Well, there we go. We've got some different voltages to look at. So let's just stop the scrolling for a minute here because these aren't changing. We've got 5 volts in the first input. And that, I think, is the raw measurement that it calculates out into an actual voltage. That is my half-discharged lithium-ion battery. That is my AA. And that is 4 volts coming from the power supply. The library doesn't seem to have a lot of fancy stuff going on. But one thing I do notice is it doesn't do anything to address the addressing. It just uses the default address, which is, 48. But nowhere in this demo sketch or any of the Adafruit demo sketches does it say anything about that. So I'm going to move on to a different library because I have many to choose from. So here's another one that's fairly well rated in the listing. This one calls itself the White Rabbit driver, and this is just the demo that comes with it, or one of the demos. Again, just like every Arduino library, there's one or more demos that comes with it that shows off its capabilities. And this one allows you to state the I2C address by saying you've either got it grounded or sent to VDD or to SDA or SCL. So you don't even have to know the numbers of them. It just deals with them that way. So this one currently is set to ground. Let's set it to use a different one just cause. Let's go with SCL and I will upload that and then we'll try it to just to prove that I2C addressing works. Duh, we kind of already know that, but why not? Okay, so when we bring that up, we notice it's just got the 16-bit input maxed out, 65535. A nice familiar number with it for anybody who's ever looked at binary counting in the past. And of course it's showing that because we haven't set the address line yet. So if I connect the address line to SCL there and hit the reset, there we see that the values have all changed. But this thing again is showing raw numbers, and I couldn't find anything in this library's documentation about how to calculate that into actual voltages. It's just the raw value coming out of the thing. If you needed that, that would be a fine library to use, but I'm not going to use it. I'm going to use a different one. This library is called the ADS1115_WE library. I have no idea what that stands for. This one also deals with the addressing, and it just does it in straight up numbers, which is fine. We already know what those are. And this example sketch has an awful lot of different options in it, all fairly well documented right inside the example sketch, which is quite nice. And it shows you what the defaults are and everything else. This particular one is set up as continuous mode. There are a few other modes, but again, for most of us, I think continuous mode would probably be the one you want. Anyway, here's what its output looks like. Again, it's doing it in volts. So we got 5 volts on the first one, which is 5 volts coming off the USB, 2.15, which is my horribly discharged lithium-ion battery, 1.23, which is a AA, and the 4 volts is what's coming off my power supply. And actually, let's vary that. Yeah, I'm varying my power supply, and you can see that it's tracking fairly well. Now, this thing says it can measure above the 5 volts. So let's see that. Yes, it can. There is 6 volts on the power supply, but 5.57 seems to be the highest that it can do. So just for fun, I thought I'd try it on a different processor just to see how well the libraries load. This D1 Mini is an ESP8266. This is an ESP32 on this Olimex board that... Where did I get this thing from? Oh, another maker sent this to me a while ago. So I will just quickly swap the wires over. I'm not going to bother removing that D1 Mini right now. I'll just reconnect everything and I'll get right back to you here. And there we go. I just threw the Adafruit library back onto that guy. And lo and behold, it is showing exactly what we'd expect it to say. And it looks like the 5 volts coming out of that Olimex board is a little bit lower. Is that correct? Yes, it is. 4.8 volts is coming out of that, not 5 volts. Okay. So it is correct. Cool. And I mean, there's no reason why that shouldn't have worked, right? Except for libraries sometimes are a little finicky, but the Adafruit library is fine with this ESP32. And again, any of the ESP chips only have one built-in analog input available. So this just seems like an excellent way around that limitation, should you need lots of analog inputs. So I guess the next thing to try is using two of these together. So connected up for voltages, I've got this potentiometer here between ground and 5 volts that's going to the first one. The second input I've got coming from the 3.3 volts. And the third one I don't have connected anything. And the fourth one I've got connected to this old Samsung phone battery, which, well, let's just see if it'll tell us what the voltage is. So I've slightly modified the sketch to address the second one. I'll take a look at that in a second, but I just... want to look at that. Let's stop it from scrolling for a second. So the first four are the same. The 5-volt bus, the lithium ion, the AA battery, and the... where is that coming from? Oh yeah, that's coming from the external power supply. Then this one, number 5, is the first input on the second board, which is a potentiometer. There's a 3.3 volts. That's nothing. And this is that Samsung phone battery. Let me just start that scrolling again and I'll adjust the potentiometer. So you should see number 5 changing here. As I do that, there we go. So that is working how I had expected it to. Most excellent. And here's the sketch behind it. It is exactly the same as the previous WE library continuous sketch that was the demo, except for I just made it a multiple. So I just duplicated a bunch of things in here. I created a second address, created a second instance, and then just doubled everything up down here. Set the comparator channel. What else was I using here? The measurement mode is continuous as opposed to single shot. I doubled up on the read channel and then doubled up on all of the printouts. Very straightforward. I like this library. It seems to be, for my level of coding anyway, the most user-friendly and the most versatile. I'm sure people who are more advanced at coding will find some of the other libraries handy and cool. There is a bunch of libraries to use for this thing. So I could go through and wire up the rest of them, but this kind of proves it to me and demonstrates it to you. And that's kind of the point of these tinkering videos, is mostly for me just to try the different modes that that these things work in and see if they will work with the various things that I've got going on around here and that I might want to do. There are a bunch of other modes that these things can do. We saw it in the library examples. We saw it in the data sheet. But if I decide that I need to use those, then I will definitely explore those in the future. But for now, this is the mode that I am most likely to use this thing in if I want a whole bunch of inputs. And yeah, the Uno and the Nano and some of the other boards do have a bunch of analog inputs. The Uno has 6 of them, and the Nano, I think, has... Does it have 8? It has, yeah, it has 8 analog inputs. But they both speak I2C, so you can add 16 more to them using these little boards. And I think that is going to come in handy in the future. Some of you may remember this monstrosity, which is working towards a DIY DMX project for controlling lighting. And the setup that I've got on it right now uses... I think it uses all of the analog inputs available on that Nano. So I could go much bigger if I chose to. Of course, I'll have to get more potentiometers, but that's minor. I'm not sure if that's what's going to happen, but I'm still waiting for other parts for this thing. So that can be back on the sidelines for a while. And in the meantime, I think that'll do it for today. If you've played with these things, let me know what applications you found for them. I think I noticed in the mailbag comments a few different people were saying that they had used them in the past. Yeah, I think it is a very versatile little thing. And if I can find more of them for the really good price I got them for in the mailbag, which isn't the price that they are currently, but, you know, I think I will make use of them several times in multiple different things. Anyway... That's enough of me rambling. Thanks for watching, everybody. Questions and comments down below, as usual. I'll talk to you later.